Dear students, this is our fifth lecture on research methodology, and in this lecture we are going to discuss reliability and validity threats and remedies. So what I will do, I will define reliability and validity, because there is lot of confusion among students about these terms, and discuss how do we ensure reliability and validity in quantitative and qualitative researches. Generally it is thought that qualitative researches do not meet the test of reliability and validity, but this is not true. Ways of determining reliability and validity of different types of designs are however different. Now the focus of this lecture therefore is on reproducibility and truth claim. Reliability is reproducibility, and I will define this in a minute, and truth claim, to what extent our findings are true, that is the validity claim. Then reliability in different types of researches, quantitative and qualitative. Then what are the various threats to validity in different types of designs? What is internal validity, what is external validity, schemas, strips and breakdown, importance of field notes conventions, and documentation of methods and procedures. So, now reproducibility and truth claim. If research is an organized and communal activity, as I said right in the beginning, it is not private, it should be possible for other researchers also to verify our results. Okay. And they would be interested. Somebody finds my interesting finding, that researcher would like to know to what extent these findings are true also. The results should be true, that is they should be undistorted by the known sources of distortions. And in this lecture I focus more on reliability and validity issues in qualitative research, although initially quantitative research is covered. Now in the context of quantitative or experimental research designs, which we have discussed earlier, there are several threats to validity. It depends on what kind of design are you using. One, historical processes of change. How to attribute change in the dependent variable or in outcome or measurements to treatment? This raises the issue of that sometimes, even without any intervention, even without any treatment, observations may be changing. Now, if this is due, if this change is not due to treatment, and this change is due to historical processes, means other processes, then there is a threat to validity. This is the meaning of threat to validity. Selection of incomparable samples for comparison, which means that if your control and experimental groups are not comparable, means they differ in terms of other socio-economic, demographic characteristics, which might have a bearing upon the results or measurements or dependent variable, then your findings are not valid. Testing, the effect of testing procedure used on measurements, sometimes the and why sometimes, most of the times it matters whether you are using methodology A or methodology B. The use of methodology, the use of testing procedures itself might affect the major bands. And if you are doing a longitudinal study or pre-test, post-test, and you change the experiments in the observations or in the studies every time, some change in the measurements or in the dependent variable might also be due to changes in instrumentation or changes in measurement procedures or methodologies to measure the change in two or more experiments or at two or more points of time. Maturation of the subjects. Maturation of the subject means that subjects will not remain same as time passes. Subjects, their characteristics, their ways of thinking, their stresses, anxieties, they will also change. So, how do we, by comparing post and pre, say that this change is solely due to intervention or treatment and it is not due to maturation of subjects? That is another source of threat to validity. And then mortality or dropout, which means suppose you make an intervention for 6 months and take measurements in the beginning, and after 6 months it's quite possible that some of your subjects in control group or experimental group might die, or they may drop out, they may refuse to be part of the experiment. And sometimes it is to be seen empirically, it depends on what kind of work we are doing and what is the rate of mortality, what is the rate of dropout. But this mortality or dropout can also be a factor in differences between pre and post. So, these are various things which we have to keep in mind while designing an experiment, that the ultimate purpose is to ensure that the differences in measurements between pre and post or at different points of time are due to treatment or intervention or experiment only, and not because of historical processes of change or select or incomparable samples or testing procedures or instrumentation changes or maturation of subjects or mortality or dropout. Now, conceptually, reliability is the degree to which finding is independent of accidental circumstances of the research. That is, if you repeat the study or someone else repeats the study, then you should simply reproduce the same results. That is reliability, reproducibility. Validity is the degree to which the finding is interpreted in a correct way. This is different from reliability. Reliability simply relates to reproducibility of results. Validity to truth, that is, it matches with other interpretations believed to be true. How do we know whether some experiment is true? If our findings match with the findings of other experiments which are taken to be true by the academic community, then we can say that yes, our findings are also true. So, there has to be some criterion for judging validity of data or findings. Validity is further divided into two parts, internal validity and external validity. Internal validity refers to whether the observed change in the dependent variable can be attributed to independent variables and the relationship is not spurious or pseudo. Let me repeat. Internal validity refers to whether the observed change in the dependent variable can be attributed to independent variables and the relationship is not spurious or pseudo. You know, sometime it may happen that empirically you find that X produces a change in Y, or changes in X produce a change in Y. But actually that may be because X affects something else, Z, and Z changes in Z produce changes in Y. So, X is not the direct cause of Z, of Y. X is not the direct cause of Y. X affects Y indirectly through Z, or there may be some other variable U which affects both X and Y, and what you empirically find as the relationship between X and Y is actually because of the fact that there is some third variable U which is affecting both X and Y. In that case, the observed relationship between X and Y, if you do not take into consideration indirect relationship through Z or the effect of U on both X and Y, can be called a spurious or pseudo relationship. So, in ensuring internal validity, we have to ensure that the differences in Y are actually due to differences in X. How do we ensure that? We can ensure that if we also take cognizance, if we take into consideration explicitly changes in Z and changes in U. If we do not do this, then there is a threat to internal validity. And in designing experiment, either in the way we select our subjects or control and experimental groups or treatments or by using statistical technique like analysis of covariance, we can ensure that the effects of Z and effects of U are removed, and what we actually get is the effect of X on Y. External variability refers to generalizability to other. Generalizability means that if you perform an experiment on 60 students of IIT Kanpur, then what you find is applicable not only to students of IIT Kanpur, but also students of other IITs or students of universities or all the people, students or non-students. That is external validity. If you can generalize findings of your research to a larger set of people, that is ensuring external validity. So, internal validity refers to the way you design your research, and external variability to generalizability. Different methods differ in terms of internal and external validity. A single lab experiment, for example, is believed to be having a high internal validity because that experiment is in your hands. You decide treatment, you decide dependent, independent variables, you are aware of proximate or intermediate or mediators or moderators. So, you can design your lab experiment, it is in your hands to ensure internal validity in lab experiments. So, lab experiments are believed to be having high internal validity, while a single case study may not have high internal validity, but is believed to be a case of high external validity, means generalization. Now, validity of what? Validity in research can refer to validity of scales or measures, and also reliability, how reliable your scales are, how reliable your measures are. Then validity of methods, as I made a distinction between experimental design and case study. Experimental design has high internal validity, and case study method has high external validity. Similarly, theories can be valid or invalid. For the same set of observations, some theories will be more adequate, some theories will be more valid, and other theories will be less valid or less adequate. More on validity of scale, there are various types of validities again in literature. I am mentioning them simply because if you read books and you find these names, you should not be confused. Apparent validity means that the instrument or measure or scale is closely linked to the phenomenon that it is obvious or which it is studying obviously. Religiousness scale, for example, has items religion. They should not be items related to political ideas or community norms. If your scale of measuring religiousness contains items related to political ideas or community norms or nationalism, then it is not a valid scale for measuring religiousness. Then instrumental criterion validity means observations match with those generated by an alternative procedure considered to be valid. In all psychological studies measuring some psychometric property, there are already some scales which are considered to be reliable and valid. If you develop a new scale, you may like to develop a new scale of quality of life, subjective well-being, job satisfaction, life satisfaction, overall satisfaction, but there are already some scales available which are considered to be reliable and valid. If the observations produced by using your new scale are similar to observations produced by other scales which are considered to be valid, then you have instrumental or criterion validity, because you are matching your findings or your observations are matching with findings which are believed to be true. So, your findings are also true. Theoretical or construct validity, which means that the theoretical paradigm that you have chosen for your study rightly corresponds to observations. In quantitative research, there are special measures for considering reliability and validity. For example, item total correlation. If you are using Likert scale and you are measuring some characteristic in terms of say 10 characteristics, then total means sum of values against all the all 10 items. Now, if you find that the values against item 1 correlate heavily with the total of all the values against all the items, you can say that item 1 measures the overall characteristic. So, by calculating correlations between single items and total, we assure reliability and validity item wise. That if you find that there is some item out of 10 items, there is one item which does not correlate with the total, then it means that item is not measuring that characteristic. That item can be deleted, and these things can be done in the pilot study. Now, the consistency between specific items and total, or consistency between different items, that is certainly a measure of reliability and validity. But if you want an overall kind of thing, this is this reliability in overall sense, or one single measure of reliability while using a scale consisting of 10 items or maybe more, can be given by calculating Cronberg alpha. This Cronberg alpha is based on average correlation between different items. Imagine that you have correlated all the items with all the items and take the average of correlations. This is what Cronberg alpha conveys. So, if Cronberg alpha is high, that means all the items are giving consistent results, and that means your scale is valid. Cronbach alpha has a specific formula for calculating measure of reliability based on average correlation. A Cronbach alpha of 0.7 or more is considered to be a good measure of validity or reliability, I should say more specifically reliability, consistency between different items. Validity of a scale is truly speaking conceptualized in terms of face validity, that your scale looks to be valid, content validity, its components, contents look to be or they are in the judgment of experts indicative of what you are measuring overall. Convergent validity, the opposite of this is discriminant validity, it means that if there is something, say level of alienation, sociologists, psychologists are interested in measuring level of alienation. If the theories say that the degree or level of alienation differs according to one's migration status, that the non-migrants are considered to be less alienated than the migrants, then if your scale of alienation is such that it gives similar values for different migrants in different cities or similar values for non-migrants in different cities at different places of destination, that is convergent validity, then it means that scale is good. That scale will also be considered good if the values obtained in the sample of migrants differ from the values obtained in the sample of non-migrants. So, if we know that migrants and non-migrants differ and our scale of alienation is giving different results between migrants and non-migrants, then it means discriminant validity. It distinguishes two different groups, migrants and non-migrants. Then predictive validity. If the scale predicts well another measure which according to existing theories can be predicted by this criteria, then it is predictive validity. If industrialization, scale of industrialization predicts the income well, then it has a predictive validity. And concurrent validity, that is correlation with other valid scores. As I mentioned earlier, that there is not one scale, there are so many scales to measure something, and some scales in literature which already exist are known to be producing valid results, true results. And if you are developing a new scale, then ensure that the value, at least in the pilot study, you can ensure that the values obtained from your scale are highly correlated with the values obtained by using other considered to be valid or true scales. Now we come to qualitative research, and as I said, our focus would be more on qualitative research because there is some confusion. Most students know item total analysis, most students know that items must produce consistent results if you have multiple items or Likert type scale. Most people today at the PhD level also know about Cronbach alpha, but there is more confusion about qualitative research, and the reason is that qualitative research does not use any standard procedure. If you look at 10 qualitative researches, then you will find that all 10 qualitative researches are using different methods and procedures. How to ensure reliability and validity in that case? This it aims at understanding nature of the subject rather as opposed to quantitative research which measures quantity or amount of thing. So this is first the difference between qualitative and quantitative research. Qualitative research aims to understand nature of the subject. Quantitative research aims to measure quantity or amount of a thing. It's like quantitative study may study consumption of different items, cereals, non-cereals, liquor, nuts, spices, rice, wheat, clothes, medicines for different people. But qualitative research aims at understanding people themselves, nature of the subject, what kind of people they are. So, or what do people think about consumption? What do people think about, what is the value of consumption to them? Symbolic meanings of consumption items. These symbolic, metaphorical meanings of the item they consume, that is the subject of qualitative research. Qualitative research claims to discover new facts, though it does not test to what extent a hypothesis is okay or can be falsified. Qualitative research is rooted in anthropological tradition and supported by constructivists and postmodernists. Constructivists are those that who say that meaning of something or findings of something can be understood only in the given socio-economic, political, cultural context, that the meaning of gender can be understood only in a cultural context, that the meaning of old age can be considered only in a cultural context. That is why the term cultural gerontology, the meaning of old age differs from culture to culture. What is old age? What are the problems of old age? What is the meaning of old age? That differs from culture to culture. So, cultural gerontology. Now, those people who take this stand that the meanings will differ from one context to another, they use the constructivist paradigm. Postmodernists are those who say there are no universal laws, no meta theories, no meta analysis, no grand theory. In sociology, there has been a long debate between functionalism and Marxism, qualitative and quantitative. Postmodernists will say that neither functionalism nor Marxism, neither qualitative approach nor quantitative approach can do justice to your problem in all circumstances, at all times, in all countries, in all contexts. There is no universe, there is no grand theory. They don't believe in grand theory. They believe more of in advocacy, in taking up the issues pertaining to vulnerable, marginal sections of society. So, the focus is on advocacy, help, helping people, helping marginal people, not on discovering universal laws. Now, qualitative researchers are committed to interacting. This is another different. Quantitative research can be done with the help of teams of investigators. But in qualitative research, you have to interact with the objects of study on the latter's home ground. If I want to study distress among farmers in Maharashtra, then as a qualitative researcher, I will go to Maharashtra and spend time with the farmers and then come up with my findings. I will not send investigators, no matter how well trained they are, to study that phenomenon. So, strongly encouraging that what the researcher takes for granted at his home does not apply in the new situation. What may be true about farmers' distress in UP may not be true about farmers' distress in Maharashtra. What may be true about farmers' distress in areas where irrigation facilities are better may not apply to those farmers who are working in those regions where irrigation facilities are non-existent and agriculture is mostly rain-fed. So, and because of this, because of lack of claim for universalization, there are different points of view and methods regarding making of social realities and cultural framing of social reality. Let us look at some of these things. In subjects' points of view, symbolic interactionism and interpretive interactionism this is one theoretical position. Another theoretical position is that of ethnomethodology, which claim that there is no reality and what we consider to be reality is constructed by us. Now, how is reality constructed in the minds of the actors? That is ethnomethodology, very similar to constructionism in a social context. Other types of theoretical positions are psychoanalysis, Freudian psychoanalysis, Erikson psychoanalysis, and genetic structuralism, okay, less used in sociology. Methods of data collection for them would be, if you are using symbolic interactionism or interpretive interactionism, then the method of data collection would be semi-structured interviews and narrative interviews. If you are using ethnomethodology or social constructionism, then the appropriate methods would be focus group, ethnography, participant observation, recording, audio-visual recording of interactions, collecting documents. Then if you are using the psychoanalysis, then the methods would be recording interactions, photography, visual data and films. If you are using symbolic interactionism, interpretive interactionism, etc., then the methods of interpretation are theoretical coding, content analysis, narrative analysis. In case of ethnomethodological position, you have conversation analysis and discourse analysis, and in case of psychoanalysis, you have objective hermeneutics and deep hermeneutics. Now, it may be difficult for us to explain in 1 or 2 minutes all these complex terms, but the idea is that what I have been saying, that qualitative methodologies do not follow a fixed, a universal pattern, and in qualitative method it depends a lot on what your point of view of subject is, what your theory is. Theory decides your methods of data collection and method of interpretation. There is not one way of collecting data, and there is also not one way of analyzing data. The meaning of coding, axial coding, MIMOs, narrative analysis, making a story or overall story or categories differ from one procedure to another. And that is the challenge for studying or establishing reliability and validity in qualitative case. Now, I must tell you, as far as the meanings are concerned, the concept of reliability and validity are same in both quantitative and qualitative research. The concept of reliability at the extent to which a measurement procedure yields the same answer, however and whenever it is carried out, and the concept of validity at the extent to which it gives the correct answer, true, correct, reproducibility and truth, apply to qualitative research also. So, as far as concept is concerned, it is same. If I say that my findings of my ethnographic study of 2 years in a naxalite affected area of Jharkhand are reliable, it means that if another researcher studies the same area and spend 2 years there and use a similar methodology, then that researcher will also arrive at the similar results. And validity means that what I have found about Maoist violence or naxalites or different political parties or different stakeholders, state, NGO, civil society actors, community members, these findings are actually true. Sometimes things may be reliable but not true, but yes, if something is true, then it is also reliable. 9 pointers to select a qualitative research method and reliability and validity, and ensuring reliability and validity. So, since no specific method can be advocated for for all qualitative researchers. I am only talking about some points you should keep in mind if you are using qualitative methods and you want your results to be reliable and valid. What do I know about the issue of my study, or how detailed is my knowledge already? So first thing, I have to use library, internet material, talk to experts, attend conferences, and equip me appropriately about the knowledge in that field. Am I more interested in generally exploring the field and the issue of my study? Am I more interested in generally exploring the field or the issue of my study? And should be replaced by or. This means I want to do a holistic integrated study of something, or I want to focus on some specific thing. I may study a community, a tribe from all points of view, or I may decide to study only the religion of that community. So focus research right away, or do I start from a rather unfocused? So I start with the community study as a whole, integrated, exploring the field, or I start from the beginning as the study of religion, focused. So it, my study may be focused or unfocused. Some researchers have done unfocused study. They have studied tribes and all aspects, education, belief systems, religion, neighborhood relations, cropping patterns, everything, while some others focus on something very, very specific. William White's study of crime did not cover all aspects, or you must have heard about culture of poverty, Oscar Lewis. Oscar Lewis focuses on poverty. Oscar Lewis does not cover all aspects of poverty, although because he is claiming that behind poverty there is a long culture of poverty. So the scope of the study is much wider, but ultimately he is focused on poverty. Why poverty? Poverty because of culture. He is not studying everything, he is not trying to understand everything about the community. How developed is the theoretical or empirical knowledge in the literature for internal validity? Because for ensuring internal validity, you must know what are direct, indirect effects, mediators, moderators. In qualitative studies also these concepts would apply. What is the aggregate I want to study? Is it personal experience? Is it interactions or situations or bigger entities like organizations or discourse? Initially, anthropologists or qualitative researchers studied only tribes, pre-literate societies, small communities, but nowadays ethnographic method is being used for studying bigger organizations also. Discourse, one of my students is trying to understand by using ethnographic or qualitative method the manifestations of masculinities in software organizations in a metropolitan city. So today we are using ethnographic method for everything. For not only pre-literate society, but also literate societies, large organizations, industries, urban areas, institutions, and so on. Then what is the theoretical background of my study, and which methods of observations fit this background? Already I have shown you a table that if this is your theoretical position, then these types of methods can be used. This will ensure the theoretical validity and also methodological validity of your study. Is it more the single case, for example, of a personal illness, experience of a certain institution? I go to one specific hospital, say Medanta, and study a particular case, one single case of a person suffering from cancer, or I am interested in or composition of various cases, or I may study multiple cases of cancer. I may also study multiple cases of cancer and multiple cases of cardiovascular diseases. It depends, and that decides the trade-off between internal validity and external validity. I told that internal validity of case studies is less, but external validity is more. Survey would be somewhere in between. Then what are the resources, time, money, manpower, skills available to run my study? I must make a more or less correct judgment of how much time will be required, how much money will be required. In writing research proposal, we have to produce an estimate of money requirement also. Then how many men and women, woman power, manpower would be required, what kind of skills they must have. They must be basic graduates, or they must be graduates in anthropology, or graduates in mathematics or statistics or what, depending on the methods. I have to look at this factor also. Then what is the claim of generalization of my study? Let me also tell you that these days nature of qualitative studies has changed a lot. Days are gone when anthropologists will go to a distant community in some other part of the country or some other continent, learn their language, live with them. Some anthropologists even spend their whole life in an alien culture. They even married there and produced kids and then wrote the reports. But these days qualitative research has also become quite technical and specific, and some qualitative research, not all, some qualitative researchers still belong in the long tradition of the ethnography and manual coding, manual analysis, manual content analysis, or story writing or narratives. But an increasing number of anthropologists are using computers, partly because they are not studying small or pre-literate societies anymore, they are studying large organizations. Computers can be used for several purposes, for making notes, for editing of notes, field notes, for coding, for storage of data, for memoing or writing reflective commentaries on some aspects, for content analysis. And one good aspect of computers is that in along with content analysis or frequency distribution of how frequently a concept appears in the document, it can also tell you which concepts goes with which other concepts normally. If X happens, Y also happens. And that means if you use computers on your qualitative data, you can not only get frequency distributions of different codes or concepts, you can also calculate things like chi-square. You can combine statistical methods with ethnographic method and arrive at some more interesting or more results. It opens your eyes to possibilities of correlations and so on. So some computer packages also give you chi-squares, then display of data, graphs, charts, narratives, quote, unquote, various types of manipulations can be done if you are using computers for drawing inferences and for verification and for report writing, for giving references, for changing references from one style to another, you can use computers. Then qualitative data analysis softwares or computer aided qualitative data analysis softwares are available for organizing, managing, coding, sorting and reconfiguring your data. They can also improve the reliability and objectivity of your findings. At least if you want to communicate to the scientific community or to engineers and scientists, mathematicians, if you say that you have used computers for analyzing your data obtained through qualitative studies, they will place greater faith in your findings than if you simply say that yes, I spent 2 years there in the field and these are my findings. Then these scientists and engineers will think that your findings are subjective. Actually, in qualitative studies, findings are co-constructed by the researcher and the people. But using computers in analysis of data can bring some degree of objectivity to your analysis. These are some popularly available or popularly known computer packages, Atlas, NVivo. These two are most known. I get PhD thesis from PhD students from different universities who are using qualitative methods, and I find that Atlas and NVivo are most commonly used. But there are many other computer packages also, that is for you to decide which package. Then there are four phases of qualitative research: invention or presentation of research design or a plan of action. Then discovery, phase of observation, second phase, measurement, field work. This phase requires checking the validity of measurement and methods. Then interpretation, obviously invention or preparation of research design, then discovery, actual work, then interpretation of findings, and then explanation. Explanation, a phase of communication or packaging. This phase produces a message. This is the phase when you are writing your research report, you are writing papers for journals, you are writing papers on request to be included in the books edited by well-known people in the field. Explanation, communication, and presentation of your findings. Or you write papers for seminars and conferences. In qualitative research, for data and for hypothesis testing, there are some parallel ideas, like hypothesis. There may or may not be any hypothesis in qualitative research. Some exploratory research also begin with some hypothesis or schema. In the language of qualitative research, hypothesis may be called the schema. Then you collect observations, strips are observations. Then check whether the observations lead to rejection or acceptance of the hypothesis or schema. And if schema or hypothesis is rejected, what are our alternatives? And should we study one site only or multiple sites? A strip might be an observed social act recognized as a unit by the nature of its characterization in the informant's language. It might also be an informal interview conducted by an ethnographer, or a more structured interview or an experiment. It could also be a document of some sort. Means observation, schema, strip. There are two types of resolutions. You are checking the same hypothesis against, you are checking a hypothesis schema 1 against data. If there is a breakdown, means if hypothesis is falsified, then you make another hypothesis, check that against the same data. Data remains same, hypothesis, alternative hypothesis may change. Or you check different hypotheses. You begin with a hypothesis, collect data. If there is a falsification or breakdown, then develop alternative hypothesis, check against other data. Strip 2 means other observation at other places, another site, and then maybe in this way hypothesis 3, hypothesis 4, or hypothesis 5, or schema 5 may be arrived at. So schemas or hypothesis may change by looking at data. Now I must also say for 1 or 2 minutes, what is the importance of field notes? Field notes also bring some kind of objectivity to your research. Field notes must be recorded as correctly as possible. Noting down your reflections in the field, they must be recorded in the field itself, preferably when you are collecting the data. And distinguish between what was reported and what was paraphrased and your interpretation. Three things: what did your respondents say, what did your subjects say, how did you paraphrase them or summarize them, how did you find the crux of them, and what are then your theoretical interpretations and context of time and place. You can, some qualitative researchers like Kirk and Miller have given some conventions, double quotation for verbatim quotes, single quotation for paraphrasing, parentheses for contextual data, angle brackets for amic lexicon, their own jargons, metaphors, and solid line for partitioning time, and slash for denoting amic contrast, for example, members and guests. Now, if you follow these conventions, there will not be a confusion in your mind later on when you are writing the report or when you are at the stage of interpretation, whether something was said by your subject as such or you had paraphrased that. Since field worker themselves collect data in qualitative research and present the findings, no field worker has seen the notes, field notes of other field workers. They have seen only the findings of others. So, though it makes it important to see field notes for reliability and validity to be sure whether somebody's findings are okay, or to analyze interview situation, to involve the actors or subjects in the research process. But since field notes are not available, as an anthropologist you have not seen the field notes of others. So, others will judge your reliability on the basis of knowledge of how did you enter the field, negotiating access, living with the subjects, subjects and their stories, research interests and interests of the subject, what to talk to them, for how long, and how was exit and made, and if there was any revisit. Remember some points: that reliability and validity are not symmetrical. Perfect validity implies reliability, but perfect reliability does not imply validity. Perfect validity is not even theoretically attainable, and to discuss validity of, say, thermometer reading, a theory is necessary. Then mercury expands linearly with temperature. If you do not believe in this assumption, then your theory also, your formulae also collapse. Thus, a qualitative researcher can ensure validity by documenting all the procedures, by letting people know exactly how the researcher prepares him or herself for the endeavor, by best possible mediation between people, him or herself, by sharing interpretations with the subjects. This is called counter structural method. You go back to the field and share your findings with your subjects, and if your subjects may be industrial managers, if subjects agree with your finding, then it means findings are okay, otherwise you may have to reflect on them. To quote Gadamer, if there is any practical consequence of the present investigation, it is concerned with the scientific integrity of acknowledging the commitment involved in all understanding. So, it is your scientific integrity, and scientific integrity can be demonstrated by demonstrating everything to which we have access. Refrain from some other points, to be careful, refrain from talking in the field, produce notes that are exact as possible, begin to write early, the report should be complete and candid as possible. Researchers should seek feedback on their findings from the field or from the colleagues, and presentation should be characterized by a balance between the various aspects and by accuracy in writing. In this presentation, I have tried to define the concepts of reliability and validity. Reliability is about reproducibility of the observations or data or findings, and validity is about the truth claims. Something can be reliable but not valid. A watch which is always running 10 minutes late can be reliable, but it is not valid. And the concepts of reliability and validity are same. In quantitative studies, you have some measures like Cronbach alpha to demonstrate your reliability. In qualitative studies, there are no Cronbach alphas, but documentation. If you want to make your findings reliable and want to be accepted them by other researchers or the community of researchers worldwide, then the measure of reliability is your documentation. Document everything, everything. How did you reach the field? How did you enter the field? What kind of people you met? At what time? And everything that happened to all your field work experiences can be written down, and they will become the source of reliability. Thank you very much.